So write your own component. So this is what we're going to be doing today, at least this morning. The idea of how it will work is that I will program this, and hopefully I will do it slow enough so that you can also do it while I'm doing it, and learn how to do it. And if you fall behind somehow, don't worry. One way is shouting, yeah, you're going too fast, and I'll slow down. There's also step-by-step instructions in README, in the README, one README file on the GitHub. So what we'll do is we'll start with an arm. That's usually the way when you want to start to write a component completely from new. It's useful to start from something that's not completely new, just to get the structure. Much as when you press, you ask for a new instrument file in the GUI, so you get a skeleton of MacStas keywords that you can use. We'll be using focused sampling. That's the most advanced thing that we're going to do, and that's governed by the equation down here. You might keep that in mind. We'll get to that. That's what we'll most demand. But what we will be simulating is a semi-permeable mirror. That is a mirror with imperfect reflectivity. So there's some neutrons will pass through it, and that's about it. So I'll change the name to something more sensible, and I call my file semi-mirror, like so. And so what I want to do is I would like the user to specify a reflectivity. I also need to have some kind of dimensions to the mirror. because a mirror without some boundaries is not very good, right? So I will specify a length. Now here's where I start to think about what I want to do. I want to specify that the mirror lives in the ZX plane, that is, it's going to be flat like so, along the beam direction, unless I turn it. That's a very simple coordinate system. And any rotations, you probably want to do like this for the mirror to actually get into the beam. But that you can do with a rotation in the instrument file. So the most general way, we can just assume that we know what kind of know the coordinate system. And it's very easy if you lay it along one of the principal axes. So I should call my mirror something. It has a C there. Oh, sorry, I want to be in the Y direction. So I'll call it Y hat. Just to be conform with these step-by-step instructions. So I've now defined default values for reflectivity and for dimensions of the mirror. Okay? That's very fine. And now I can actually go program my mirror in the in the trace section. So what I want to do now here, I'll just write it in comments first. The algorithm I'm trying to go here is to say I want to go first move my neutron to the plane of the mirror, then I want to check if the mirror has been hit. Am I within the boundaries of the mirror? If so, then I check should I be reflected or not. Remember that we wanted to have an imperfect mirror that could also transmit. And if I'm reflected, then I should adjust the direction. And if I'm not, then I should do nothing. Because then I just transmit my movement. And then in the end, I adjust the weight of the ray. If necessary. Now, the first one is kind of easy. Simply do this. This is a McStas keyword, prop underscore x zero. It's a McStas macro that helps you, which means move the neutron to the plane where x is zero. That's exactly the zy plane. And that just does it for you. And so the neutron is now in that plane. And now we need to check whether or not if it's within the boundaries. So I do the if statement, and I check if C is less than C depth, if I can spell it, half of the C depth, it has to be bigger than minus half of the C depth, and obviously Y has to be within as well. If this is so, we should do something. Hmm. are reflected. Now remember that we have a reflectivity. The easiest thing to do is to say, okay, I roll some dice and I figure out if, and then I compare that the score of the die to the reflectivity, and if it's above, we maybe do a Monte Carlo choice. And this is done like so. So I pull a random number. I store it from between 0 and 1. I store it in the variable R, and if R happens to be less than the reflectivity, I should reflect. Section so that you can also see something, see your mirror in working when you do MC display or something. Okay, so that's actually, now we actually have a mirror. Spectrum is obviously not very interesting in this case, because we don't have a... Now, I have to do this by hand, because...
Or you could actually browse for it, if you want. You could, then you can see if it's a problematic thing as well. Yes, I think so. Probably browse. I guess you're in the home dimension. So that's probably also where you should send your comment there. So that's also where you should save your file. And it is. So that's good.
Downstream of the source.
put them in my head.
Is it X you want to rotate about?
Yeah. No, I hope so. Right? This is the one we want to rotate about. Let's just put that graph in. Thank you. Let's do a simulation. It's pretty quick because we don't have much instrument. Now we start to see something. We shoot at a mirror and we most of the neutrons probably most of the neutrons miss, but there is a dip in the middle, which is our mirror reflecting neutrons. Okay, so let's also try to catch the reflected beam. This we can do by adding an arm, for instance. That to see if things are going the way we think it should be going. Just invert colors for a while. And we can see from the bottom here that there's one detector there and one monitor there. So that seems to be working. We seem to have gotten our geometry right. Okay. Now we can see there's a blob in the middle of the mirror neutrons, and there's some stuff that misses the mirror that goes straight through, and also something in the middle which also goes, but that goes through the mirror. Right, so things seem to be working quite nicely. Now, if I were to see that the intensity goes right, if I close down the focusing window, so I only focus on, I make sure that I actually hit the mirror, nothing misses it. And this should, we should definitely get half of the intensity on the. So you can see from these numbers here that they are identical, or as close as can be within the Monte Carlo distance. So we get half of our intensity passing through the mirror, and half of our intensity be reflected. We also can look at this number here, saying that we've got approximately 500,000 events in each monitor, which is what we hope for, right? Now, suppose that we want to steer our statistics. We really don't care all that much about transmitted events. We really want our reflected events to be the ones that we use. So we want to move events from here to there, but not affect the intensity. Because this is good. We shouldn't, by computing in a different way, we shouldn't change physics. So let's go back to our mirror. How do we do this? And we can also look back at our governing equation here. We need to find a weight multiplier, which is the physical probability for an event divided by the Monte Carlo probability for that same event. So, let me say, I define a new parameter up here. I can say that I call it a fraction. And I say that I want 90% by default. 90% of my statistics going in the direction being reflected. And that means that I now have a probability for the Monte Carlo probability for this type of event of 90%. And so I have now what I need. Say P, so this is C lingo, or multiply some factor to P, which is the real probability divided by the Monte Carlo probability. And this I have to add an else clause here. Do the same thing or similar thing for the other branch of now the probabilities involved are the conjugates of those. So obviously if you have a reflectivity of something, then the probability for not reflecting is 1 minus that. And that is actually what we need to do. I should perhaps add one other thing. We should add a dot in the maximum clip so that we actually scatter on a bigger one. So, shall we see how this works? Now we have to do one thing. When you're writing a component, you have to make sure that your instrument gets compiled again. So you have to make sure that you save your instrument, or in fact go here and say compile instrument, and you can force MacStas to actually compile your instrument, because it doesn't see that you have changed the component within the instrument file. Fraction. actually, if you look at these numbers, the intensity numbers on the monitors have not changed. Well, for at least very little, only within the Monte Carlo error. But the numbers of events have changed. So now we get 100,000 events in the transmitted branch, and we get 900,000 events in the reflected branch, which is exactly what we want. And so we have in fact built ourselves a semi-permeable mirror with also focused sampling on in it. And so if you haven't done it before, you have now built your first component. Are there any questions to that right now?
So I have a question for the fraction. I still don't understand what the Monte Carlo probability for. It's just a number.
It is just a number. It's saying that I would rather compute, I would rather spend time computing the reflected neutrons than spend time computing the transmitted neutrons. And that means, this is one way of doing it, is saying that, okay, in 9 out of 10 cases, I do reflect, but we use the weight to make sure that those 9 out of 10 rays are now less important. They represent fewer neutrons. You can think of it this way. If you were to have a mirror and you used a Monte Carlo probability for 90%, but you still had a reflectivity of 50%, then you would be overestimating your intensity in the reflected branch, because if you had 10 neutrons coming in, then you would have 9 neutrons being reflected. Okay? But we have 10 rays coming in, representing the 10 neutrons. And so each of these 9 out of 10 rays now should represent a little less than 1 neutron in order to get the intensity, no matter what, should still be 5 neutrons, or we should still get 5 neutrons on average in the reflected branch, because you don't change the reflectivity, you just change the amount of sampling you use to go into.
So it just means that using more computing ability to calculate the reflective neutrons.
Yes. So
in other words, it's also a kind of indication of a region of interest in parameter space. So it's the possibility to kind of forget about the transmitted beam, because what you really want to simulate is the reflected one. Yeah. So it goes together with what you saw in the samples also. So power in is one example. You have actually 3 possibilities of that. It's a simplified model and everything, but you can get transmitted, which is very nice to do the moment you have something inside, so in a concentric arrangement, to have a single crystal or something inside your powder sample environment. So there you perhaps don't want to spend too much on what goes to the coherence gap and not the coherence gap. So this is a way of tuning your simulation, reducing the variance on the number that you're really looking for. So it is a variance reduction technique.
You buy an improved variance in the reflected branch by sacrificing variance in the transmitted branch. Because let's see. Look at the numbers that came out here. You see that the error estimate on this one is almost an order of magnitude larger than for the reflected branch. So we sacrifice the precision on that number to buy some precision on that number, in this case. get you buy precision in one direction by sacrificing precision in a different direction. But maybe you're just interested in knowing exactly more or less where the transmitted neutrons went. But you're not really, or if you don't require the same position on that one. So this is the way, this is the reason to do this.
And this is special for McStas because I didn't see such function in other one parts.
It is quite common in ray tracing simulations over the board for optical and for neutrons. It's not uncommon to use these white wave factors as well. It's a reasonably standard technique, but it's for sure it's heavily used in that sense.
Yes.
Okay. Without further ado,